Hello, my name is Cameron Skidmore. I'm a global partner solution architect at Red Hat.
And I'm John Walsh. I'm a product marketing manager here at CyberArk.
And we're going to kind of step through the ways in which cybersecurity threats happen and the different ways that information that's really valuable to organizations get compromised. So, John, it really all starts with the bad actor, right? What do we know about the bad actors out there today and kind of what they're after?
Well, the attackers are looking to get whatever they can get. They're trying to get money, and they're trying to get your valuable assets, right? And it all starts with the human element. So the attacker is looking to compromise you where you're probably weakest. And we're all people. We all make mistakes. You know, it's part of being human. And that's what they're looking to compromise.
Yeah. There's no amount of security training or enablement that's going to allow for a company of 100,000 people or 50,000 people to be completely perfect all the time, right? Mistakes are going to happen. And they're eventually going to get access to someone's laptop or workstation, especially someone like, you know, a nation state or someone along those lines that has a lot of time and a lot of resources. So bad actor has gotten access to someone's laptop. What's on that laptop? What are they going to do next? What are they looking to do?
Well, that's where the trouble just starts, right? And you may be thinking, okay, I have MFA, you know, multi-factor authentication. So it's going to tell me if like someone's trying to use my credentials and get access to my machine. But what could happen is through like phishing, they get the credentials, then MFA protects you, you think. But we have something called MFA fatigue, where the user gets tired of answering over and over again.
Yeah.
And they just hit accept, or they hit the wrong button by accident, or whatever it is. In some cases, the attacker might try to contact the victim and say they're from another organization or something, and they need to hit accept so we can move on.
Sure.
You know, it happens, right? It has happened, unfortunately. And that's where the trouble just starts.
Okay. So even if you have MFA or something along those lines and those security measures, eventually something's going to crack, right?
It could. It's possible, yeah. Right? Let's try to keep it positive. It could happen, yeah. Right?
So I heard about it happening in the news, so I know it can happen.
I know. That story's been driving me crazy.
Yeah.
But in any case, from there, they can get access to what's on the hard drive or what's on the shared drives, shared cloud drives that machine has access to. And from there, they can find like scripts, test code that might have like credentials or secrets embedded in them. They'll get them access to other parts of the organization or other databases or services or something like that.
Okay, so because these credentials haven't been properly locked down, they're gonna immediately try to access one part of the organization and then move vertically or laterally to try to get access to different systems that this person maybe would have never even thought about accessing in the first place.
Right.
So let's say they got a developer laptop, yeah, and they were able to get access to the development environment,
sure,
the test environment. So from there, what are they going to do?
Yeah. In this case, maybe even the victim was not a developer. As you said, like they had access to it, but they didn't know they had access to that shared drive, which these credentials were sitting there. And they were sitting there because someone wrote some test code that was just testing some things out. And it had in the clear a password, let's say 123456. That's the password for the hotel Wi-Fi that, yep, I used.
Yep.
Don't tell anyone. But it was on there, right, by mistake. This person didn't even know they had access to it. The attacker's searching to see like what they can do, what can they find, what they can use to leverage to get to the next phase of the attack.
Okay. And maybe that next phase is the production environment, right, where all the goodies take place.
Yes, that's what the password was.
Yeah, that was, right? That was the password. So now they have access to the production environment, and we went from a kind of less risky situation right until like, okay, now we have live fire drills going on. Like this
person
is getting access to what's the making the company tick, the organization tick underneath.
Now it gets interesting.
Yep. Tell me what happens next.
Well, and there's a lot of compliance mandates that say like this shouldn't even happen. But, you know, sometimes in tests, I used to be a developer. Developers do some things just to try things out. And with the understanding like, you know what? No one's ever going to see this code,
right?
But you check things into GitHub, you know, or put them on a shared network drive. That's where someone else could potentially see it. And even though you trust the person here that was compromised and didn't expect they would ever like go after your code, but they got compromised and then they had access to this stuff. And that's the attacker is the one who leveraged it. So from production, they can get access to a lot of other more interesting things like production databases or services you might be using, or maybe your other cloud environments where they could run software or do Bitcoin mining or anything like that.
Right. So they went from the production environment, got some data.
Production database.
That's where all the goodies are, right?
You got credit card numbers, maybe your user information, internal employee information, maybe pay information, or more importantly, probably to you as a company, your most valued IP assets.
Right.
Maybe it's software for your latest release that's coming out, or maybe it's something that you're working on getting a patent for.
Yep.
Right. Things you really don't want compromised that make you a company that's like doing well and profitable and healthy.
Yep. Corporate espionage could lead to this. Extortion, crypto mining, like you said, on the machines. There's just so much they get access to. And then at this point, like, where could you possibly stop them? They're in your environment. You may not even know they're in your environment for a while unless they're just pranking you for fun, which,
right.
Again, we hear about in the news, but is mainly the tip of the iceberg with these threats. And they're extracting valuable data out of your organization. And there's nothing you can do about it at this point.
Yeah.
So I think I understand the problem now. I understand how this bad actor starts with this very, very small foothold and then expands their influence, their reach.
Spread the attack.
And then just moves on from there to gather as much information of value as they can. How could we have stopped this? What is a effective means of defense?
And I like what you say that you may not even have known that you were compromised, right? You're relatively lucky if you find out right away. Mm-hmm. In a lot of cases, if the attacker is looking to use the information as long as possible or wait for the right time to use it, they'll do whatever they can to cover their tracks and make sure you don't even know you've been compromised,
yeah.
Right? Like, as they say, there's two types of companies, right? Those that have been compromised and then those that just don't know they've been compromised or just aren't telling anyone.
Ignorance is not bliss in this situation.
So in this case, I'd say, like, so helpfully, you can see each of these arrows in blue. Each of these is a phase of the attack where you could have stopped things where they started. And obviously, you'd like to stop them at the beginning.
Right.
Like here, when they get access to this person's machine through something like endpoint privilege management.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Which is a part of a privileged access management system, all essential parts of identity security.
So privilege access management, PAM, at the center of this could have really prevented a lot of risk at every single turn here. And like you said, like, it could have stopped this from happening. It could have stopped the spread of it from here to here all the way through. But because there was no orchestration of who's accessing what, an authentication, an authorization from a central provider, we didn't have that, right?
Right.
It was just one step to the next, to the next, to the next.
Right.
And you know, in defense, 50,000, 100,000 person company, it is really hard to manage all of these identities. And without a really strong platform to universally lay down the policy and enable people so you don't get in their way and cause more headaches with the security. It's always that, like, speed versus security. It's hard to have both, but with the right technology, you can. That's kind of the crux of it, right? I think a lot of people don't have bad intentions when they simplify their lives and kind of maybe loosen the security bonds along the way. So it's important to have security tools that aren't cumbersome.
Exactly. Yeah. The most successful companies with the security teams that are successful, they work together with the developers and other people as partners, right? And I've heard a lot of people call their developers customers when you're talking to them.
Yeah.
And you have to ask, like, well, do you mean like external customers? They're talking about their internal customers, right? And that signals that, you know what, they want to work with them. It's not simply just make them do this, you know, and don't try to find a solution that works for everyone, right?
Yep.
Otherwise, you might like have shadow IT where people try to like get around security controls and, you know, like, sure, you could find ways to stop it, but it's best to work together collaboratively. That's the best outcome.
Yeah, I think that sets certain security providers apart from the others. And I can't help but notice here when I'm looking at the workstation, I see a RHEL workstation as a Red Hat solution architect. Test, prod, I think of OpenShift, all of these different ways in which, you know, Red Hat tries to empower the cloud infrastructure of our clients, and it makes me so happy that we've done the work that we've done with you folks over at CyberArk to make sure that all of our products work so seamlessly with
your non-humans, right?
Non-humans
So, like, I mean, we talked about like the EPM stopping at the endpoint, but also securing the non-human access and the human access as well. And the non-human access, that's where you're going to secure those secrets or credentials of the automation scripts or applications that might be sitting here in test, like all those things together.
Yep.
Like we have, you have your automation platform for Red Hat, you know, very key part of this, right? And as well as OpenShift.
Yeah, I mean, non-human identity is important, as important, if not more important in some cases, to secure than the human identities at this point.
They're both important.
They're both important.
It's just that the non-human side of things has been like multiplying with the growth of AI, more automation, cloud, and DevOps.
Yeah. Well, I thank you so much, John, for breaking this down with us. I think I understand kind of the method and chain of attack that usually takes place. And, you know, I'm, again, grateful again that we have the solutions we have in place to make sure that Red Hat's secure and ready to go when it comes to this kind of thing. So thank you so much again for joining me. Maybe we should break down a few of the products next.
Let's do it.
All right. Yeah.